there's a fountain flowing from the heart of the Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty stains. Let that river of life wash it all away. Talk, have a good time.
Then you left.
Welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. And for everybody who is streaming in, welcome. Glad you're worshiping with us. My goodness gracious. I don't know where you are. You may be in other places. Right up here in northwestern Pennsylvania, we are really experiencing the beginning of
winter.
Not winter. Not winter, the beginning of fall, really the beginning of fall. That's right. People from Georgia, whose blood are now thin, you know, it gets chilly up here. welcome in the name of Christ. We've got some announcements in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Now understand, right in the back, we're still taking noodle orders. And if you haven't ordered your noodles,
it's too late. we are making noodles tomorrow night. Hopefully, we need the last drink.
Okay. To help with the noodles. And this, if this could be the last. This could be the last noodling night. So if you have missed noodling, tomorrow would be the time to come. It's not too late. You can come and bring a friend or a spouse, you know, depending on what you want to do. So that would be doing next tomorrow. We've got, the studies on Wednesday morning and on Thursday evening, so you might want to take note and come to one of those. Paula, you've got something coming on with the Brunch Bunch. October 27th.
Friday. We'll meet here at 10:30, leave as soon as everyone gets here, and we will go to Foxburg Pizza, and then we will go to Hilliard's to a glass blowing center where we will watch a demonstration, and then they have a gift shop.
So that's on the 27th.
Yes.
Now that's a Friday. Usually y'all go out on Thursday. This month, though, it'll be on a Friday. Right. So just take note that it's on a Friday this time. Now we've got Halloween coming up, right? And what do we got going on Halloween?
Trunk or treat on Halloween here from 6 to 8.
Trunk or treat from 6 to 8 here.
If you would like to donate candy, you can have that here by the church, to the church by the 29th, so we can get the tree bags packed up and ready to go.
Okay, and on trunk or treat. Encouraged to wear costumes. If you want, just make sure your costumes are tasteful. Okay, so we're going to be doing that on October 31st. Are there other announcements that anybody here might have before we get started? Yes, Ellen. Okay, we still have some space for crafters. Okay, so if you know someone who does crafts and would like some space, we got applications still on the table. You can do it online. You can apply online, or you could call the church office and we'll take care of you. So, or talk to Alan. Yeah, Jay. Okay. Absolutely. 202 quarts can float a small boat. So, that deacons did a great job. Yes.
Two birthdays.
Who might they be? Ed.
Ed
and Melody, and I'm looking at Melody through the window. Hello, Melody. I think since we got two birthdays, as always, yes. Yours is Friday. Yours isn't in there. Should be in there. That's my fault. Okay, so we got three birthdays. All right. Is that why you came? Just to have us sing happy birthday to you? Come tomorrow night. You'll have more than you can take. All right, let's sing.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Outstanding. And what's really interesting is if you add all the years together, you get a, Ed looks really surprised, you get a number. You do get a number. Any other announcements? Well, then, brothers and sisters, as God's people, let's worship God together.
Blessed are those who give without interest, who offer themselves and expect nothing in return. Hallowed are the places of small sacrifices, where the thankless work is done. Sacred are the acts of true adoration, for they reveal the heart of the divine. Envy not the givers in the crowd, earning praise for their generous deeds, for they have received their reward. For those who give in secret, more shall be given unto them. They shall be called blessed, the true saints. The restorers of streets to dwell in.
Okay, let's all, as we get the service going, let's all stand up and let's sing, Make Me a Blessing.
We're just doing verses 1 and 2, correct?
1 and 3.
1 and 3. Oh, I think Jake said 1 and 2.
Oh, 1 and 3?
Yeah, okay,
okay,
awesome.
Whatever.
1 and...
Follow.
We'll figure it out.
Darkness is rife, making the sorrow.
time.
Lemonade, right? And I took out a container out of the refrigerator, took out a container, put it on the counter. Now, did it look like lemonade?
No.
It did. It was yellow, just like lemonade, right? I took it out, put it on the counter, looked like lemonade. I thought it was lemonade. I poured it in a cup, and then I tasted it, and what was it? Chicken broth. It was chicken broth in a container in the refrigerator, but it looked like lemonade. Yeah. I gave the cup to you and you said
I wondered why you guys took so
yeah, because we were eating chicken broth. Yeah, Ooh was right. But see, at least I tasted it. Now that looked like lemonade, right? When I poured it, it poured like lemonade. Only it was a little thick. I poured like lemonade, and when I held it in the cup, it looked like it. And even, you'll never believe this, it smelled like no vegetables. It was just broth. Didn't smell like chickens. Didn't have any feathers in it, right? You know? Chicken broth. So I tasted it. You know, this is what we're going to talk about today. Because sometimes when you look at a tree, a lot of trees out there, but for a tree to bear good fruit, it's got to be a good tree. You know, if it's a bad tree, it's not going to draw. Even if it looks nice, if it's a bad tree, it's not going to bear good fruit. That's right. How do you know if a tree is a good tree or a bad tree? What do you have to do? How do I know? How did I know that that container held chicken broth and not lemonade? How did I know? It looked the same. It smelled the same.
I tasted it.
That's right. So bad. No, you can't taste a tree, but you know what you can taste from a tree? Well, you could taste a leaf. You could taste the apple or the pear or the orange or the lemon or the banana or the chicken. You could taste that from the... Yeah, right. Chicken is a bad example. But you could taste the fruit from a tree to know what kind of tree it is. And it's that way with us. You people will know who we are and will know whether we're really good or not so good by the things that we do and the things that we say. Right. You got an apple tree?
But
they're green apples. They're sour apples. Probably Granny Smith. No, I said Granny Smith apples. They're kind of apples.
Yeah. We didn't even plant them.
Oh, you didn't even plant them. They just grew naturally. Okay. All right. So, all right. Well, that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about, you know, sort of part of what we're going to talk about is being, you know, bearing good fruits, doing good things, showing that we are good trees and not chicken broth in a container that I thought was lemonade. Okay. So let's bow our heads, have a word of prayer. She would have been in bad shape. She would have spit it out.
Or not try it.
Or give it to me like you did. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us this time together. And help us to be good trees that do good things, that bear good fruit. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Okay, Jordan, would you hand me these, please? And ladies, stand up, please, if you would. Okay. You know, here's one in, suitable for your age group, and here's one and two, because you're sort of on the line. And Ray, here's the rest.
No.
You just want one?
Two.
Oh, two. Okay. Two. Okay, now what are we come on, what are we gonna say? You wanna say. Just God loves us? Okay, we'll do God. Okay, turn around. I want you all to have an outstanding week. Don't drink any chicken broth, assuming it's lemonade. And what I want you to remember all week?
God loves us!
Yes. And if anybody wants to drink some chicken broth, there's a container in the refrigerator right now. It's a little lumpy, which, yeah, Marty, it wasn't good. We come to the part of the service where we have the opportunity to lift our prayers to God. Now, you've got all kinds of needs and concerns in the bulletin, of which you may want to take note. Are there any additions or updates to anybody that's in the bulletin? Or any additional needs, any names we want to add? Well, we want to remember to continue to pray for our brother Bob Johnson, who lost his mother-in-law, first marriage, his mother-in-law, and they were very, very close. We did the memorial service yesterday, and thank you for all those who helped prepare the food for that. And he lost his brother. His brother's funeral was last week, so he's carrying a lot of weight. So we want to remember him in our prayers. Anything else we want to remember? Absolutely. We want to lift Trina up in our prayers. Thank you. Anything else? Yeah. Barbara has a joy. Yeah. Think of how much fun you can have together. He's going to be there all the time. All the time.
I know.
Yeah. And once he finishes the projects, nothing to do all the time. He can start advising you on your work. That'll be fun. Yes. You can get that house. Yeah. Yes. A lot of advice. That's what my mother looked forward to. So, yes, absolutely. She'll need prayer. That's what people say to Debbie, that they pray for all the time. Yes. So thank you. Any, yes. Absolutely. Absolutely. And we definitely want to remember Betty Phillips, who is still ailing. We want to lift her up in our prayers. So, thank you. Anything else we want to remember today? Well, with these in mind, let's go to God in prayer. And since part of the prayer will be confession, we'll be confessing a little bit. I'll be praying and confessing. And then y'all will have the opportunity to lift your concerns to God, and we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let's go before God now in prayer. Lord God, before we say anything else, we got to thank you for giving us the opportunity to gather together in your name. It's starting to feel like fall, Lord, and some of us appreciate that more than others, but it just shows that you're involved in your creation and that we move through seasons. And that's a good thing. So we want to give you thanks and praise for the weather that we're experiencing this time of year that we can enjoy. Now, in just a little bit, we're going to hear your word read and proclaimed. And we're going to be looking at some parables that your Son and our Savior Jesus Christ taught when he was here on earth. And we're going to start today by looking at two little bitty parables, one shorter than the other, that deal with wolves and fig trees. And as we'll see later, both of them involve folks that you call false prophets. And you say a lot about false prophets in those two parables, and we appreciate what you had to say. The trouble is, sometimes we're taken in by false prophets. We believe what they tell us, and we follow along after them, and sometimes following them leads us away from you. They challenge us to do things that are very different than the challenges you give us. As a matter of fact, often they encourage us to focus inside, to focus on what we want or what we think is best, rather than focusing on you. And Lord, when we follow these false prophets, and you know, Lord, their message is often really, really sweet and easy to follow, forgive us. And shift our focus, even though it's difficult, shift our focus so that we can see your truth, not just what we want to see. Help us to respond to you, not to our own desires and interests. Help us to do that in the name of Christ. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. We're going to lift up to you those needs that are in the bulletin, and we're going to lay before you all those things that weigh heavy on our heart. Lord God, hear us as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us, and of course, thank you for loving us. But right now, thank you for forgiving us. And we believe we've been forgiven. In fact, we believe we've been cleansed, and we appreciate it. Also, thank you for responding to our needs, and we believe that you will, because we've lifted these needs up to you in the name of Christ our Savior, who taught us to pray, praying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now, would the ushers come forward to collect our offering?
Nobody changes the world,
standing in the crowd.
Nobody's voice is ever heard
until they open their mouth.
Won't let a loud go quiet, won't let the saints go silent. Let's turn it up, tell the world what we're about.
Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to make this offering to you. Guide and direct the leaders of this congregation that these our gifts may be put to good and effective use. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Now, this morning we're going to start a new sermon series that we're going to be in until the beginning of December, entitled The Parables of Jesus, The Parables in the Gospel of Matthew. Now, as all of y'all, I'm sure, remember, we did something similar last year. You remember? Good. Only that last year we did it on the parables found in the Gospel of Luke. This year we're going to do it in Matthew. And so over the next couple of months, we're going to be looking at eight parables that are unique to the Gospel of Matthew. And even though they may not be quite as well known as those from Luke, I mean, how can you beat the Good Samaritan and the Prodigal Son? I think when we take them together at the end of the series, we'll have a much better understanding about what the kingdom of God is really, you know, all about, and how we might be good citizens in that kingdom as we try to do the best we can with what we've got. Now, that's what we're going to be doing until the beginning of Advent. Of course, before we get into the stories themselves, I think it's important for us to all be on the same page about what a parable is. You see, in English, parable comes from the Greek word parabole, parabole, which means riddle or allegory. In other words, a parable is a story that generally explains something that's pretty hard for folks to understand, you know, like the kingdom of heaven, or that challenges us to do something that may be difficult for us to do. It's kind of like what Stephen Kendrick, the writer and producer of the movies Fireproof and War Room, said. He said, Jesus communicated parables to the secular people around him. And he used stories that were very relevant to their lives. And he was taking heaven's truth and packaging it in a human context. Now, that's what he said. And I'll tell you, I think he's spot on. And it's those stories that we're going to be looking at during this series. And this morning, we're going to start with two little bitty parables. We're going to start this with two little parables about a group of people that I think we all know are out there, but that frankly we're not always real good at identifying, even when some of their influence starts affecting us in here. And right now I'm talking about folks whom Jesus called false prophets. False prophets. You see, for the next 10 minutes or so, we're going to focus on these men and women who, even though they are dishing out pure, unadulterated baloney, sure seem to have a lot of influence over some very sincere and dedicated believers, ultimately distracting them from their own relationship with God, but also distracting them from their relationships with one another. And to do that, we're going to take these two parables offered by Jesus, and we're going to focus on three things that we can know about these folks who either intentionally or unintentionally, accidentally, mislead a lot of Christians. And like I said, it's all grounded in these two parables, which Jesus told his disciples at the end or near the end of his Sermon on the Mount, right after challenging them to go through the narrow gate and right before saying, not everyone who calls me their Lord will get into the kingdom of heaven. Only the ones who obey my Father in heaven will get in. We'll talk about the kingdom of heaven later. Now, this is what Jesus said. Watch out for false prophets. They dress up like sheep, but inside they are wolves who have come to attack you. You could tell what they are by what they do. No one picks grapes or figs from thorn bushes. A good tree produces good fruit, and a bad tree produces bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. Every tree producing bad fruit will be chopped down and burned. You can tell who the false prophets are by their deeds. Now that's what he said. And I'll tell you, it's in these words shared, that I think Jesus offers us three really important lessons about false prophets and, for that matter, false teachers. For example, first, I believe Jesus is told his disciples and is telling us that false prophets should be expected. We should expect them. I mean, good night, nurse, the first thing he said was, watch out for crying out loud. In other words, regardless of how focused or how godly or how informed we assume that we are, There are plenty of people who could distract us from the truth by telling us things that that are just plain wrong. I mean, they are. And I'll tell you, I really don't think the reason they're doing it is all that important. You see, whether these false prophets are motivated by greed or by ignorance, whether their intention is malicious or maybe even sincere, there are folks out there who seem to embody the type of person Paul warned the Romans against when he said, they claim to be wise, but they are fools. Now that's who they are. And sadly, if we choose to listen to them and if we choose to follow them, who becomes fools too? We can look in the mirror. In fact, they are exactly like the kind of people Jesus warned his disciples about a little bit later in the Gospel of Matthew when he said this. Someone may say, here is the Messiah, or there he is. Don't believe it. False messiahs and false prophets will come and work great miracles and signs. They will even try to fool God's chosen ones. But I have warned you ahead of time. If you are told the Messiah is out in the desert, don't go there. If you are told that he is in some secret place, don't believe it. The coming of the Son of God will be like lightning that can be seen from east and west. Where there is a corpse, there will always be vultures. Let's just say that according to Jesus, false prophets have always been around with their false messages, and man, they are here to stay now. And for that reason, he started this passage that contains two little parables, with the words, watch out for false prophets. In fact, the word he used here was the same he used right after he told his disciples that he was sending them like lambs into a pack of wolves. So be wise as snakes and innocent as doves. You see, according to Jesus, we need to be alert. I mean, we need to be aware of a reality that we are going to face whether we like it or not. Because false prophets are here. Therefore, we need to be as wise as snakes. I'm looking at my wife. She's shaking her head. We need to be as wise as snakes, thinking about what we're being told and questioning things that just don't sound right. Because I think we all know, if something doesn't sound true, what? It probably isn't. It probably isn't. And I'll tell you something else. If the person talking, if the person teaching gets all mad at us and all defensive when we ask legitimate questions, and I'm not talking about the trapping questions, but legitimate questions. If they get all mad and defensive, man, that has got to be a red flag. Now, to me, that's being wise. But according to Jesus, we also need to be as innocent as doves. In other words, we need to be open to what we're hearing before we shut it down. We got to listen before we turn it off. I mean, if all questions are encouraged and answered, and if what we hear makes sense, well, even though we might not be ready to buy the farm, we sure might want to spend some time looking at the property. You see, we need to be alert because we can expect to run into some false prophets. And based on these parables, I think that's the first thing we can know. And second, I think Jesus is also telling us that false prophets, man, they're going to cause a lot of problems. And I'm talking about for us personally and for our church. My gosh, they are what? Wolves impersonating sheep, right? Which makes the sheep very vulnerable. And you know, given the fact that in the animal kingdom, sheep are not the sharpest knives in the drawer or the shiniest apples on the tree. If they encounter a lot of false prophets, wolves in sheep's clothing, man, I think you could count on the flock being scattered, right? And the sheep being distracted from becoming the kind of sheep God created them to be. In short, these false prophets could cause a lot of trouble. In fact, it's the kind of trouble that Jesus described a little later in his gospel. You will be arrested, punished, and even killed. Because of me, you will be hated by people of all nations. Many will give up and will betray and hate each other. Many false prophets will come and fool a lot of people. Evil will spread and cause many people, now listen to this, evil will spread and cause many people to stop loving others. Whoa. Now that's what Jesus said, to stop loving others. And I'll tell you, that just in and of itself is horrible, isn't it? I mean, not only are these false prophets, these wolves in sheep's clothing, Not only are they going to fool a lot of people, they are going to convince good and sincere and dedicated believers to stop doing the one thing that Jesus has commanded all Christians to do, right? They're going to convince those Christians to what? Stop loving others. Stop loving others. And if we decide to stop showing love, regardless of the hymns we sing, and regardless of the prayers we say, and I'll tell you, regardless of the number of folks we attract, if we stop loving others, man, we stop being the church. And I'll tell you something, it doesn't matter what name we put on the sign. I mean, how can a community claim to follow Jesus Christ and not love God and not love their neighbor as themselves? They may be a fine group. They may be fun at parties. But how can they claim to be the church? The church of Christ. But that's what these wolves will try to get us to do. And for that reason, we need to be prepared. You see, I think we need to be prepared for those who, through their teaching, want to distract us from doing what we know we've been called to do. And I think we need to be prepared by knowing as much as we can about what actually is true, even though that might mean putting in the time and the effort to actually learn both what the Bible says and what the Bible means. I'm telling you, we need to be prepared so that when we face what's divisive, and when we face what's distracting, and when we face ideas that may sound all biblical, but they aren't, we'll have the ability to stand up on our hind legs and confront what is false by what is true. I'm telling you, in a world that has come to believe that truth is all relative. There are alternative truths. Truth is all relative, and truth is all personal. It's what you think is true that's important. Man, we have got to be prepared to stand out for what's right. Because if we don't, we can expect these false prophets to cause all kinds of trouble. And according to Jesus, what Jesus said in these two little parables we just read, that's the second thing we can know. And third, based on what we read a little while ago, false prophets can be identified. False prophets can be identified. And frankly, in my opinion, that may be the most important thing that we can know about these folks. You see, it's all well and good to know that we should expect them, right? And it's all well and good to know that they can cause all kinds of trouble. But if we can't identify who they are, we are up the creek without a paddle, or maybe a kayak without a paddle. But fortunately, that's not the case. You see, we can know who these false prophets are by simply looking at the fruit they produce. I mean, Jesus said it. A good tree produces what? What does a good tree produce? Yeah, it's not, you know, chicken broth. A good tree produces good fruit. A bad tree produces, As Jesus said, you can tell who the false prophets are by their deeds. It's like Jesus said, again, a little bit later in the Gospel of Matthew, when he was confronting some Pharisees who thought, get this, thought his power to heal people, to cast out demons, thought his power to cast out demons came from Satan. Jesus said, a good fruit tree produces good fruit. A bad tree produces bad fruit. You can tell what a tree is like by the fruit it produces. You are a bunch of evil snakes. So how can you say anything that's good? Your words show what is in your hearts. Good people bring good things out of their hearts, but evil people bring evil things out of their hearts. I promise you, on the day of judgment, everyone will have to account for every careless word they have spoken. On that day, they will be told that they are either innocent or guilty because of the things they've said. You see, according to Jesus, that's how we can spot a false prophet, by what he says and by what he does. But you know, to do that, for us to be able to do that, man, we are going to have to be honest. We're going to have to be honest. And let me tell you why I think honesty is so important. Do you know why false prophets are so successful in what they do? Well, I believe the reason they attract so many people is that they tell us exactly what we want to hear. They tell us exactly what we want to hear. I mean, they proclaim a comfortable God. One who not only shares all our opinions and all our assumptions and all our prejudices, but who is also controlled by the words we say and the works we do. In other words, they proclaim a Christless Christianity, a Christless Christianity, a religion that never demands that we make a real sacrifice, and that never demands that we actually love those people we don't like. In fact, that never demands that we do anything other than what we already want to do or believe what we already believe. Now, this is what they tell us is true. That's what they tell us is gospel. And sadly, a lot of believers buy it because it's exactly what they want to hear. I'm telling you, exactly what I want to hear. But I'll tell you something else. Because I want to hear it doesn't make it true. And you know what? Deep down I know it. I know it's not true. And I'll tell you, that's why we have to be honest. Honest with ourselves and honest as we look at others, particularly those who lead us. So I'm telling you, you got to be honest when you look at me. Because it's only when we're honest that we'll be able to understand and apply these words offered by James in his letter. Are any of you wise or sensible? Then show it by living right and by being humble and wise in everything you do. But if your heart is full of bitter jealousy and selfishness, don't brag or lie to cover up the truth. This kind of wisdom doesn't come from above. It is earthly and selfish, and it comes from the devil himself. Whenever people are jealous or selfish, they cause trouble and do a lot of cruel things. But wisdom that comes from above leads us to be pure, friendly, gentle, sensible, kind, helpful, genuine, and sincere. When peacemakers plant seeds of peace, they will harvest justice. I'll tell you, when we decide that being honest is more important than being comfortable, I think we'll be able to use what James wrote to separate those good, productive trees from the wolves that are prowling around. You see, we'll be able to do this because in these parables, Jesus said that we can identify the false prophets. And that's the third thing we know. And that, my friends, is the first two parables we'll look at from the Gospel of Matthew. And man, are they ever important, especially nowadays. You see, in what he said, Jesus challenged his disciples to watch out and to recognize that there are sheaves out there, wolves out there wearing sheep's clothing. And to be ready and willing to judge a tree by the fruit it produces. And I'll tell you, that can speak to us as well. You see, based on what Jesus said right here and right now, we know that false prophets should be expected. Therefore, we need to be alert. And we know that false prophets will cause all kinds of trouble. Therefore, we need to be prepared. But here's the good news. We also know that false prophets can be identified. Therefore, we really need to be honest. And you know, if we do this, we just might be able to avoid some of the pain and the animosity and the outright hostility that false prophets seem to produce. And next week, we'll look at another parable from Matthew. This one dealing with, you got a guess? Weeds and wheat. Weeds and wheat. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you so much for giving us your word and giving us such a strong warning about false prophets. I mean, we listen to a lot of folks around. Thank you for warning us that there are wolves hanging around in sheep's clothing. Help us to be aware that they're out there. In fact, help us to expect to see them. And help us to realize that when they're there and that when they're teaching, man, they can cause a lot of problems. But also help us take the time and make the effort to do what you say we have the ability to do. And that's to identify them. If we're honest with ourselves and with them, help us to do that. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Now, before we close the service this morning, by singing a song and a benediction, I offer to you all this invitation. If there's anybody that's got a question about the sermon or the service, please talk to me about that after we're done. If you feel the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and is interested in how you might respond, please talk to me about that as well. Now, let's all stand up and let's close the service by singing, "Oh Jesus, I have promise." And hey, Amanda, are you able to come up here? Or are you busy with other things? Like little girls and such? Because you do such a great job leading.
First and the last? Yeah, one and four. One and four.
Okay. One and four.
Yeah.
And Jake, for doing such a good job on the board, and Jordan, for helping me so much, just keeping me focused. Thank you, you captured it right there, keeping me focused. Brothers and sisters, go now in peace. And recognize that there are false prophets out there, so be alert. And they look like us, they sound like us, my goodness gracious, because they dress in sheep's clothing, but they're actually wolves. Therefore, they can cause a lot of trouble. So we need to be prepared. But also realize we can identify them if we're honest in how we look at ourselves and at them. And to empower this walk, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
hope they're not leaving because it's some dad songs.
No, but that's only sometimes that's like where people.